Welcome to another discussion about the Carolina Bays. A 2009 paper by Richard Firestone claimed that Carolina Bays can be found in Texas. An image in his publication showed what appears to be a 2-kilometer Carolina Bay, but no coordinates were provided for this geological feature. The paper by Richard Firestone was published in 2009 in the Journal of Cosmology with the title The Case for the Younger Dryas Extraterrestrial Impact Event, Mammoth, Megafauna, and Clovis Extinction 12,900 Years Ago. Many aspects of the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis are discussed in the paper, but I will investigate only the claims about the Carolina Bays. The abstract says, at the base of the Black Mat at 9 Clovis H sites in North America and a site in Belgium, numerous extraterrestrial impact markers were found, including magnetic grains highly enriched in iridium, magnetic microspherules, vesicular carbon spherules enriched in cubic, hexagonal, and N-type nanodiamonds, glass-like carbon containing fullerenes and nanodiamonds, charcoal, soot, and polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. The same impact markers were found mixed throughout the sediments of 15 Carolina Bays, elliptical depressions along the Atlantic coast, whose parallel major axes point toward either the Great Lakes or Hudson Bay. The caption of Figure 3 in this paper says, the Carolina Bays are approximately 500,000 elliptical, shallow lakes, wetlands, and depressions up to 10 kilometers long, with parallel major axes pointing toward the Great Lakes or Hudson Bay. Similar features found in fewer numbers in the Plains states also point toward the Great Lakes. These bays were not apparent topographical features until the advent of aerial photography. The figure shows an image of a Carolina Bay in Texas and four lines directed toward the Great Lakes. The endpoints of the lines are in the Texas Panhandle and in the central western part of Texas. To investigate the Carolina Bays, I used a LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davias. The orange color indicates areas where Michael has cataloged Carolina Bays along the East Coast and Nebraska. Recently, Michael has also cataloged some Carolina Bays in the Texas Panhandle, and we can see the orange color indicating their location. This map shows three circles centered at Saginaw Bay, which is the location proposed by Michael Davias for the extraterrestrial impact. The circles correspond to distances of 500, 1,000, and 1,500 kilometers from Saginaw Bay. Before looking at the potential Carolina Bays in Texas, I would like to remind you of the four mechanisms proposed by the glacier ice impact hypothesis for the formation of the bays. First, a meteorite impact on the Laurentide ice sheet ejected ice boulders in ballistic trajectories. The secondary impacts by the ice boulders liquefied on consolidated ground close to the water table. Oblique impacts of ice boulders on liquefied ground created inclined conical cavities. And finally, viscous relaxation reduced the depth of the conical cavities to produce shallow elliptical bays. This is a LiDAR image of a typical, well-preserved Carolina Bay in North Carolina. The Carolina Bays have several distinguishing characteristics. The elliptical geometry of the Carolina Bays characterizes them as conic sections, and this implies that they originated as inclined conical cavities. The bays have raised rims that are characteristic of impact cratering. The stratigraphically raised rims are produced by compressive horizontal forces during the penetration of the projectile into the target and by debris ejected ballistically around the cavity. The raised rims are formed from the overturned flaps of the penetration funnels. The Carolina Bays occur only on unconsolidated ground that was liquefied by the seismic vibrations of the ice boulder impacts. Saturated ground can be liquefied by seismic vibrations of magnitude 6 or higher. Ice projectiles are able to penetrate liquefied ground without shattering. The bays are oriented toward the Great Lakes, which is the location from which the ice boulders were ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. The Carolina Bays are generally located within 1,500 kilometers from the Great Lakes, which is the approximate range of the ballistic trajectories. The Carolina Bays have a wide range of sizes and they frequently overlap each other while maintaining their elliptical shape. This is a LiDAR image showing the structures cataloged by Michael Davias near Tulia, Texas, in the Texas Panhandle. This is the same image without the markings. The colors represent the topography of the terrain with a color gradient that repeats every 10 meters of altitude. The land inclines toward the east. The top left of this image is at 1,166 meters above sea level, and the bottom right of the image is at 1,025 meters above sea level. This is a drop of 141 meters over a distance of about 120 kilometers. There are many features to consider, so I will look in detail at two that resemble Carolina Bays. One of them is crossed by a road. It will give us the opportunity to get a street view. This feature appears elliptical. It seems oriented toward the Great Lakes, but it does not have raised rims. The topography indicates that the basin has sides that slope toward the center by about 4 meters. I used a program called Web Plot Digitizer to mark points along the perimeter of the basin. I then fitted an ellipse to the points using a least squares algorithm. The fit is very good, so we can say that this basin is elliptical. The basin has an orientation of 224.7 degrees, which when extended toward the Great Lakes encounters Lake Superior at a distance of 1,660 kilometers. The 2009 paper by Firestone proposed a series of extraterrestrial impacts by the Great Lakes that included an impact in Lake Superior based on the great depth of this lake. The caption of Figure 10 says that the profile of the Great Lakes shows that the lakes are deep holes in the earth. Four lakes extend well below sea level, and the bottoms of three lakes are deeper than Death Valley. The holes are too deep, up to 1,330 feet or 405 meters, to have been caused by glacial or stream action, and no recent tectonic activity has occurred in this region. Three of the holes are in a direct line, much like crater chains that have previously been observed on the Earth, Moon, and most recently the impact of Comet Shoemaker-Levy on Jupiter. The second feature that we will examine has a circular pool in the center, but the topography reveals an elliptical depression. The elliptical depression has a length of 1.67 kilometers and a heading of 217.1 degrees. Plotting the points along the margin where the topography color changes from green to yellow produces a remarkably good elliptical fit using the least squares method. Extending the heading of 217.1 degrees toward the Great Lakes ends up west of Lake Superior at a distance of 1,532 kilometers. The headings of the two basins that we examined do not converge at a common point. US Highway 87 makes a slight deviation around the circular depression. The proximity of the road allows us to use the Google Map Street View feature. This is a satellite view of the same area. We can really appreciate the difference that LiDAR makes. Without LiDAR, we can only see farmland divided into regular plots of 1 square mile covered with circles made by pivot irrigation systems. We can get the street view of our feature from the position indicated by the arrow. There is not much to see. A difference of 4 meters between a depression and its rim is very difficult to observe from ground level. We can go back to examine the depressions near Tulia, Texas, and question whether these indentations are impact structures related to the Younger Dryas impact. We know that this is farmland, so there is some loose soil on the surface, but we don't know if the depth of unconsolidated soil is enough to allow the creation of inclined conical cavities. The Texas Panhandle is not known for karst. Karst is a topography formed from the dissolution of soluble rocks such as limestone, dolomite, and gypsum. It is characterized by underground drainage systems with sinkholes and caves. Evaluation of these features in Texas will definitely require some geological field work. The indentations of the Texas Panhandle do not seem to be Carolina Bays. Most of them don't have an elliptical geometry, and they do not have raised rims. It is impossible to say with certainty that their alignment converges by the Great Lakes. Also, the features in Texas seem to be fairly uniform in size and spacing. They do not have the variety of sizes and overlaps that are so prevalent in the Carolina Bays of North Carolina or the shotgun blast appearance of the bays in New Jersey. We come back to Firestone's impact structure. It looks like a Carolina Bay. It seems to be elliptical with raised rims, and it seems to be oriented toward the Great Lakes. Texas is beyond the 1,500 kilometer radius of the major Younger Dryas Glacier ice bombardment, so we have legitimate grounds for questioning whether Texas has impact basins like the Carolina Bays. Firestone did not provide coordinates for his Carolina Bay in Texas, and I was not able to find it even though I searched at the endpoints of the lines that he drew from Texas to the Great Lakes. I circled those endpoints in red in this image. Texas is very big. I need your help. If you use the LiDAR visualization tool by Michael Davies, take a look at Texas and try to find Firestone's structure. His scale bar indicates that the feature has a length of about 2 kilometers, so it is similar in size to the two features that I examined in the Texas Panhandle. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of this video below. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.